main commitment is to this group, which works on issues of transparency and accountability in terms of our government. I feel the only way that hold the government is accountable is if you know what it's doing. And that's our main mission. And with that, I'm going to turn this, if you haven't noticed, there are box lunches. There's three different kinds. Hopefully we met everybody's dietary need. We're actually going to start off with, what are you showing me, Emma?
The Finnegan ceremony.
One of the main things this group does is annually give out an award to honor people who work for openness in government, and we now entertain nominations for that. And there's a sheet here, or you also can find it on our website, which is MnCogitation.org. And we're certainly looking for qualified people to honor for their work in openness in government. There's one of our past recipients, there's another, and another. So people that have worked on these issues for a long time, so we like to honor. So we're going to start with this lunch, but I'm going to turn it over to Don Geberling, who is our moderator, who's also the spokesperson for our group. He was there at the inception of the Minnesota Government Data Practices Act and spent 30 years working on the act and modifying it over time with the help of state lawmakers such as Mary Liz. And he's going to be moderating our panel today.
Thanks, Gary. I have to quit talking about how much I need technology. Good afternoon. Thank you for coming. I'm going to introduce the panel. He's got a video he's going to show us so you can get a sense of what the real world of body cameras are. I had a chance to see some body camera video a few months ago and began to understand some of the limitations and to get a better sense of some of the issues in the real world. And before we do that, I'll introduce the panel. I have one note of sadness. Professor Nikita Levy-Collins is sick today and she can't make it. Okay? And she asked me to apologize to all of you. And then she asked me to apologize again. I finally said, Nikima, I've known her for a number of years, and Nikima, we just could have let yourself for me. She probably tried to do that. So she's sorry she couldn't make it. She was looking forward to doing it. So I'm going to start to my immediate right. Panel member, Mary Ruth Holberg, County Commissioner in Dakota County, starting her second year. Before that, Mary Liz was, I won't call you Ms. Holberg, or Commissioner. We worked together a long time. Mary Liz was on the Lakeville City Council, almost blue again, for 3 years. And she spent 16 years in the legislature. And enjoyed a number of positions, including Chair of the Transportation Committee, Chair of Ways and Means, and was always the data practices person to go to in the House of Representatives. If there's anybody in the state of Minnesota who really works on and strongly believes in keeping government accountable, she's near the top of the list. To her right is Chief Eric Gieseke. He's chief of the Burnsville Police Department. Some of you may know that Burnsville has been using body cameras longer than any other department in the state of Minnesota. So he's got lots of practical and other kinds of experience. The chief is a graduate, unfortunately, of the University of Wisconsin. He is a Minnesota native. We had a chat about the RAS scale of the University of Wisconsin. All of you know that the University of Wisconsin has a student center where they serve beer. It's called the RAS scale. He's been on the Burnsville Department for 27 years, including the last three as chief of the department. With that, I think we'll set the video and then we'll... Some basic ground rules. He's going to show the video. They're both going to talk a little bit about their view of body cameras, issues, positions, etc. Then we're going to go essentially to open discussion. I've got some questions to kind of get us going. You're encouraged to participate in the discussion with questions. And, you know, I'll be the moderator, I'll call on you, that kind of thing, okay? And I think that's it. So.
I'm good with all this. Can everybody hear me okay?
Yep.
I'm going to, before I play the video, I just want to give you a little background on Burnsville PD and the body cameras, just so you have some idea of how we got to this video, which I'll show in just a second. Again, thanks for allowing me to be here. I have no knowledge. I can either confirm or deny anything about the Rathskeller. I haven't been a cop my whole life, but I've been really proud to work for Burnsville PD. It's been a great organization. A couple of things. We started body cameras back in 2010. June of 2010, so it's been almost 6 years. I was a captain back at the time, and the chief at the time, Bob Hawkins, was presented with an idea from the rank and file. That's really important to note. This idea came from the frontline folks, not from the top, not from the chief, not from the captain. It came from one of our frontline officers. He was also a use of force instructor. And at the time, we saw the advertising for body cameras. It's also important to note, at the time, our officers were equipped with and used tasers. Most of you know those are electronic control devices. And some of our tasers at the time had a camera on that piece of equipment. And that was important to document the use of force, and specifically when you're using a taser, which is considered a higher use of force in some arenas, to document that piece of it. We thought it was important to record it. So we were just experimenting with that camera system. And then along came this wonderful piece of equipment, which I'm going to pass around so you can truly appreciate what pioneers we really were. So this is what we first had in 2010. And this is the Axon body camera. This is what the officers wore. And you can see it's kind of hard to walk into a call and act like you don't have something on your head. It's pretty transparent when you walk into a house. But we had these for the first couple of years, and as you can see, like Don Gerling mentioned, RoboCop. That's what a lot of people call us, RoboCop. So the first challenge we had was, okay, this is kind of neat technology to give us an opportunity to record from the point of view, eye line of the officer, but what do you do with all this stuff? So we had officers taking the cables and tucking them behind their shirt, and cable management was huge. These do come apart, but so that was a challenge. One of the things we liked about these is, because it was the point of view, if you're in a squad driving around, you could capture the driving violations, you could capture the landscape as you're driving along. We also had in-squad cameras at the time. So being the smart people that we are, I thought, why pay for in-squad cameras? We did the same thing here. So we eliminated all our in-squad cameras. We took the time, we're really expensive, $5,000 or $6,000 a piece, and so we went to this model. But this is kind of how it all started. We did this for about 2 years, a good piece of equipment. And we thought, well, we did like about this here. You have this piece here, it's a computer, basically, what it is. After you record an incident, a good example, and this happens frequently, you pull somebody over for going through stop signs. And the first response you get, and we've all done it, I've done it myself, did I really stop, or did I stop, or sometimes you get preoccupied with day-to-day life. And they might argue with you, well, rather than arguing with somebody on the side of the road, you could just simply show them a video and you can both agree, yeah, you might do it. So there were some really practical benefits to having this out there, but this is no longer available. But you can see, again, I'm proud of our cops for coming up with the idea of being willing and able to do it, but this was the first piece that we had. And I'll pass it around, and certainly, it's not going to record anything, it's old. It's actually the Burnsville Historical Society back in October. They put together a display of Burnsville history. That was part of history. The Burnsville Historical Society wanted that. So that's pretty important. So it evolved. Cable management was a huge issue. So Taser, and again, I don't work for Taser. I don't promote any particular company. But at the time, that was the only product available. Nowadays, you can Google body cameras, and I can't keep track of how many there are, how many options. But at the time, there was limited options. They realized having something that big and awkward created problems in cable management, so they came up with the next generation, which is this model here. It actually plugs in, and you have, it's called the Flex. So it's a smaller camera system, easier to manage, but the issue is you still have cables. Whenever you have cables, you have problems. So eventually, I'll pass this around as well. You got, that's still available, and then they just went to the body cam, which is, this is similar to what we have now, where the camera's built in here. It's a different piece of equipment. But what are we missing? What did we lose? Yep, so we lost. We gained, you know, ability to carry it, more comfort, less cables. So we lost the eye point of view. We also, unless you're really tall, if you haven't noticed, I'm not real tall. You don't get to see yourself driving around. If I have one of these when I'm driving around a squad car, you're seeing the dashboard. So we lost a lot. So we're trying to figure out a way to get the camera system back. But this is really kind of where it's at today. They continually change. There's different designs, different companies. Mounting systems, for the most part, are wearing on your chest. Anybody see another obvious problem with this?
Perspective.
Is it dislodged?
It's dislodged. And where is it, Minnesota? We wear jackets.
Oh, yeah.
So there's all these little things that you kind of learn over the years. So Burnsville, we're not perfect, but we kind of worked through all these things and figured out some products are better than others. And we don't have a playback with this. We lost that computer, right? If the computer going around, you can play it back. That, at the end of your shift, would actually upload. Well, what do you do with this? We report, then what? Well, then you have to get smartphones that sync with the camera. Now, I don't even know technology, so I'm pretty impressed I can even talk about things syncing, right? But that's an added expense and consequences, because if you're out as a police officer, and our department handles about 50,000 calls a year, I see Commander X with Henry and Sergeant Skips from St. Paul. How many calls a year does St. Paul handle?
We're about 300,000.
300,000. So there's 300,000 calls potentially that could be recorded. And if you don't document or record the case file or the call number so it's matched, you got problems. Now down the road, that'll probably change the technology. For now, most systems, at least the ones we have, you need to manually enter that information, so it creates problems. So without that, we had to invest in smartphones with the officers so they could sync with the camera, and you can actually document and put the case file in, so you can manage the data that you're collecting. Does that make sense? Any questions on what I've said so far?
Where is the data stored?
After the shift, it goes into a docking system, and it's in that secure place called the cloud. And that's where we keep it. And I'm not an IT person. I wish our IT person was here to talk about the security that's in place to protect that. I know that's an issue. But I don't make decisions unless I talk to people that are much smarter than me, that can convince my boss and city manager that we can store data in a place that's safe and secure. That's the goal. So.
Yeah. Chief, that's Taser's part, right?
Yes. I'll just pass this around. I want to give you a quick overview of what that is. I'm going to show you a video here quick. We got these cameras in about 2010. We did a pilot project. We started off with just a handful of officers. Let me tell you, some really thought it was a great idea. Some didn't want anything to do with it. It's just like you all have concerns. Our cops have concerns too. I don't want the chief. I don't want administration. I don't want Big Brother watching me and everything. I do my day-to-day operations. It's complicated. We make mistakes. So 2010. Some fair amount of buying, but we still had challenges and obstacles. I will tell you, only 6 years later, most of our cops, there's still a few that aren't really excited about this, but it's here to stay. Don Gilman and I joke, the horse is out of the barn. These cameras, whether you love them or hate them, they're everywhere. But the vast majority of our officers now have all have examples where it's been a benefit to them, where it's helped them, where it's demonstrated what they do out there in a professional way. And there's always opportunity to do things better. And look at the video for that purpose too. Interestingly, when we hire people now, part of our interview process, we ask them, do you know we have body cameras? Well, I hope they know they're interviewing with us. What's your thoughts on it? Are you willing to use one? Most of them, it's interesting, will tell you, they expect it. They expect to have that technology out there, where years ago, 20 years ago, that was not a good approach, in my opinion. So.
How do these videos play out in court?
Well, I'm going to show you a video. But typically, I can give you feedback from our city attorney, who deals with the vast majority of our videos, because most of the stuff we do, I've said this before, I'll say it again, it's pretty boring stuff. It's, the majority of what we do is a lot of fun to watch. The city attorney views most of those important cues for traffic or misdemeanor level stuff, and we've had good success with it. I've spoken to our city attorney about that quite a bit, and they're supportive of it, too. So. Yeah.
Is it just as simple as sliding
this
button to put
the thing
on?
Yeah, this one, that puts it on and you would just click it to activate this model.
Oh, okay.
So a little bit different. This is where the flex portion sticks in.
Yes.
Again, I want to point out, just like anything else, these cops are bad enough. When you're a young cop and you learn how to do traffic stuff, it's complicated. Where you stop the car, you call it in, you run the plate, you turn your lights on, you put your spotlight on, you get your stuff on, you put your flashlight out, and then you gotta make sure you activate it. So it does take some system still to turn it on, turn on automatically. There are some systems that will do that, but, so again.
It looks like SWAT has a signature.
Yep.
Into lights or something.
I was a young officer, you had to turn your radio on every time you got out of the car, and got used to doing it, and now it's like, okay, we gotta get used to doing this. What if you forget, somebody's gonna teach you to do it on purpose? Well, we're human, we're not robots, we'll make mistakes. This one's good.
James, what are the rules of activation?
We have a pretty good policy, there is some discretion, but typically it's when you're making your arrest, making a traffic stop, anytime you're stopping somebody, pedestrian stop, checking out a suspicious vehicle, searching a vehicle, those types of things, if you're in pursuit or responding to a domestic, those types of things. So it's the stuff you're most likely to stop somebody from doing what they're doing, but there is discretion, because in the police world, you can go to one call thinking it's an up and deal and can turn into something completely different. So if they can explain why they thought it would be important to activate it, do not that. If they don't activate it and turn on later, they should have probably had it, then they need to explain why it wasn't activated. Sometimes it's human error, sometimes it can be fault quickly, or sometimes it's training. So anything else? That help?
Yeah. The other question is, if someone wants to see the video, a particular video, is there a problem?
Can you come in and make a data request? We get a fair number of those. Most of our data requests are actual police reports. We've had people come in and want it for various reasons. And again, it might not be instantaneously or instantly, but we'll do our best to get it to you. We'll have to review it to make sure we don't release stuff that'll get us in trouble. But it's available to the public if it's under the current laws that allow us to do that. So, anything else? Should I answer? Okay. I'll share this video here. Now, this was about the data escapes when we deployed these, 2010 with a handful, and it wasn't until 4.5 years later, until 2015, we had all of our officers. We have 75 sworn, 55 what I would consider frontline officers, and with back last year, back in 2014, we had all of them deployed. So all of our frontline officers, people that are out there handling calls, I don't have them, have cameras now. This was about 2011. It was with that first version I sent around, the Pro, the head-mounted one. So it gives you perspective on how quickly things can change in this profession. What's interesting about this, it's important to note, this call actually takes place in Burnsville Police Department lobby. In theory, people have an idea to come to the police department, it's a relatively safe place to be. Matter of fact, there are agencies out there that advertise, if you want to sell something on Craigslist, we'll meet you at the police department, which is good, but it's not perfect. So, our officer in this video had just cleared a call. Giving some family advice on the matter. So they literally, as a mother and two little girls, you can just see barely them leaving the lobby. Try to edit that out. But so they were just in the police department making a basic report. And so we're thankful they were not involved with this or injured in this process. But I'll share the video quick. And again, this is with that first generation that I sent you on group.
Thank you.
point of view, who can tell me what just happened there? Y'all just saw it, any comments?
Looked to me like, my first question is, why was the video already running? Was it because of the people that just preceded? Or did he have a reason to leave?
I haven't talked to you about that, just to be clear, there's a buffering on here, so you can activate it and it'll capture 30 seconds beforehand. And the call before, I wasn't sure why he was recording that particular call. I think it was a domestic related situation.
So, here, that this guy comes in and he's leaving and has another, and that responding commands, the officer apparently called backup, and the backup officer must have been with the taser. I couldn't tell from the video that he's with holding the gun or the taser.
Look at that. Who else can you see? Thoughts? Comments? What hand?
He's not allowed on phone. Couldn't tell what was going on.
Yeah.
Couldn't see that.
Not perfect. Cameras aren't perfect. anybody know what hand the knife was in? Positive? You testify that in court? do you want to watch the video before you do a report, officer? Was it his right hand or his left hand? Well, come on, officer, you're trained, aren't you? No, I'm just teasing you, but that's, I got to watch that video and go, okay, whose hand was it in? It's tough.
Also, do you have the officer to look at the video prior to writing?
We allow that. Yeah, depends on the situation, some law can press to remember. I think it's important to move that conversation. We want to get the reports right. So, and I didn't even make fun of Representative Scott, hopefully you didn't, but that's, I've got to watch that video many times. I'm like, this is right, I think it's left hand. Yeah, you kind of second guess yourself when you're under stress. But what else did we see in there?
I'm curious with the obvious juveniles in the background, the individual coming in, you're back to his image, the image of the juveniles on the front end of that or not.
And that's something we could probably do. That's one of the things when you release, you know, if you try to redact everything, and you can realize it would be hard to recognize them or follow who they were based on the activities of the building. That's one of the realities. When those things come in, you try to, like, you want to redact everything, you need to redact.
Also, I mean, juveniles
are
just in a public space. Let's say your officers are out on the street and some kids and their parents get off the bus, and you're waiting for somebody else to get off the bus. I mean, it's just in a public space. There's no expectation of privacy.
So anything about the video? Anybody comments? I mean, again, it's a perfect note, but it demonstrates how quickly things can go when you're not anticipating it. And then you ask yourself, could you write a police report based on that? Was the officer expecting that? Probably not. His level of stress is up. Good communication with the officers. He got on the radio. I thought he did a good job just trying to talk him down. I mean, he's like, whoa. The guy walked in. What he tried to do is in the parking lot, tried to commit suicide. So he slit his throat. So the officer was a little bit, I'm not going to lie, a little bit flat-footed. We're in the police department in the lobby. I'm probably a little bit more at ease than we should be, right? We're conditioned white, or maybe yellow, we're not just, you know, thinking we're going to get attacked, but he was, whoa, what's going on here? The guy's got a knife in his hand, blood coming through his throat, so he's trying to process. As cool as a cucumber. You know, I got someone in the lobby, and the cops from the PD going, what did he just say? We're human.
He also put some space between the
guys.
I like that. He backed way up. He didn't try to crouch in on
it. And I appreciate that. He's trained in CIT, crisis intervention training. He's done some different training negotiating skills, so I thought he handled that very well. And then when the partners came out, the cavalry came, and they're like, I'm going to go help them partner. And he's like, whoa, whoa, whoa. Yeah, back up. And what you heard was the taser. And again, there's different opinions about a taser, but this one, you took them down. A couple of the officers were excited when they got out there and saw that. Did you notice the tall, older senior guy? Calm down, we'll put it. No, so he settled that down. That was one of the street sergeants. Sean Mahaney, a good friend of mine, who retired, but he's got a lot of experience. It's good to have a supervisor on the streets. Calm down, slick with the gloves on. They called for an ambulance and those kind of things.
Why did you redact this thing?
Just because he was put on a hold afterwards. And so,
helpful.
Yep. You know, respect his privacy. It not embarrass anybody.
How difficult was it to do that?
It's changed, so the redacting thing, I think, is getting easier. You continually find ways to do it, and it's easier. When you have one image, it's much easier than when you have multiple images. This one was not labor intensive. I didn't personally do it, but I know that's a big issue, redacting, how you redact, and all of that.
Yes.
Go ahead.
I was just going to say, I want to say in my own defense, that camera was very blurry. If I did the cop scene, I hope that his vision is better. If that would have been me, I would have hoped that I would have seen clearly, either that I believe is right or left hand.
Absolutely.
I mean, if I identified it, I think he would have needed to watch that video over again to realize which hand and knife was there.
Well, you know, again, human error, you might second guess yourself or ask for the right hand. It's a small thing.
Now, I work at the Star Tribune. Let's just say we hear from Burnsville PD that this event happened and that an officer is wearing a body cam. And we say, well, we want that body cam footage because we want to see it. How quickly would we get that?
It depends on, how complicated it would be to redact, where it is in the process. I would, the major event, the shooting, I would have to work with our legal counsel and our folks to say, can we release it? And if it prevents a riot in Burnsville, I'm all for it. If we can release stuff that we help the public calm down and have confidence or have a better understanding. But again, it depends. That's a good question. I would work with the media. I would say, well, here's what we got going. It's not going to be instantaneous because we need to figure out everything. And,
but the legal counsel would give you the guidance, essentially. You'd be sort of deferring to that.
I guess the whole big picture. Mm-hmm. The benefit of releasing it if we can, if not, it's complicated. But
I just ask if you have denied any requests?
Not to my knowledge. We've worked, we've had some requests. It takes us longer process, but some things are going to take longer. But please don't bomb me with requests. Just work over us. I have a very dedicated staff, and they work hard, and we try to meet deadlines and data requests, and we're humans, and we're governments, so we do more requests, and we need us to do more. So, we try to work with people on this.
So I'm curious again about that question about the officers being able to view the footage before we make their reports. Doesn't that lower the evidentiary value of their reports? Shouldn't it be like an independent evidentiary value? So that they're actually doctoring their own recollections versus trying to match their report to the video?
That's a debated issue. I believe that if the officer would want to be able to look at it, but maybe in some cases they would look at it, just depends on the nature of the call. I know speaking with some of our officers on basic stuff, they don't watch it all, they don't have to go and get their notes and stuff. If it's a high profile thing that could in your career, do something, you might pause. You might want to look and say, there's different schools of thought. I don't know, say, call if we have an opinion on that. There's varying opinions out there. I'm not saying it should be all one way or all another way. I'm more of a case by case totality of circumstances and those types of things.
We don't require our officers to watch video. We don't have body cameras, but we do have dash camera. But it's not a requirement that they do it. And so it's sometimes there are instances where they can look back and say, well, I don't remember exactly how many times I said drop the knife and that kind of thing, and you want to go back and refresh that. But there are also examples out there that happen where what the officer perceived and also what they knew that isn't on the camera, sometimes looking at the video can actually distort their memory. And that's typically much more important in a higher end issue. And so at that point, then what would happen is an advocate for the process would look at it and say, I've heard what you said. There's nothing in the video that I think is going to distort that. If you feel more comfortable watching the video, you can watch the dash cam video. Or they might say, listen, go with your statement and don't watch the video. I think your statement captures what you need to capture there, and it isn't going to muddy that. So there's no.
Somebody intervenes in that process?
Is that correct.
Just to be clear, St. Paul and Minneapolis, they have much more experience in those higher critical incidents than Burnsville does, so that's why I put it on the. I know this isn't about Burnsville, me and I'm looking at the clock, and I know there's other people I want to talk, so
yeah.
I'll turn it back to the facilitator.
You read my mind. But Bill, did you have a question?
Yeah, just one quick question. That the video seemed to be fairly low resolution. Is that, are you recording in higher resolutions as of late, or is there like an intention to increase the resolution?
couple things. That, and I don't know if things are recorded, just you've used this video many times to copy or copy it, please. I don't know how that impacts it. Moving forward, I know the product will use Taser. Videos coming out in high definition. So that's going to be moving forward. So it continually improves. But, yeah.
Don? There's one more question back here.
Hold on.
No, okay.
Okay. Commissioner Holt.
Mary Liz.
Go ahead.
Well, I think you've just said about 10 times it's complicated. I mean, it's complicated. And I think I'm going to try and be fairly brief in this. Can you hear? In the back, can you hear me? Okay. I'll be fairly brief in this initial comment period because I want to make sure that we have plenty of time for questions and address those issues that you're most concerned with. But the reality is the Minnesota Data Practices Act has not kept up with technology evolution in any way, shape, or form. When you look at how long license plate readers have been used on the streets and the fact that we just got legislation last year to address this. The legislature is going to have to address this in one shape or form. And my question regarding the juveniles in that tape is one of the issues in that we protect identities of juveniles in current law, but we were dealing with pieces of paper, names, you know, on a piece of paper. If you can only imagine if there was an incident outside the entryway to a rock concert, how would anybody ever be able to ascertain whether an individual on that tape was 17 and a half years old or 18 and 1 day old? I mean, there are just certain things that do not, that are in current law that just are impossible to apply to a video. And so those are the types of things that are going to have to be addressed in a policy related to this technology. You heard the chief say, you know, we don't have generally the high level or high end is the terminology cases. And so in my mind, I believe that communities should be able to tailor their policies for their communities within parameters set by the legislature. So some communities may want cameras on at all times. Others might provide discretion to the others. For myself personally, as an individual, I think a very important concept that has to be addressed is what happens on private property. In order to get help from law enforcement, law-abiding taxpaying citizens, in my mind, should not have to be submitted to being videotaped in order to get the help that they need. I myself personally can provide a situation where there was a juvenile in my home. I had never seen this young woman before. My daughter, I got home and she was there with my daughter. They were maybe 14, 15 at the time, and Kelsey, my daughter, said, "Can so-and-so live with us, Mom?" You know, and so first of all, the fact they'd never seen this young woman before, and that, you know, she wanted to, well, what happened is it was a situation in which there was a young lady, single mom, boyfriend, bad things going on. And then later on through the course of the evening, this particular boyfriend not only he impersonated an officer trying to find out where I was to get at me. That whole situation on a videotape, I would have never done what I did. I called the Lakeland Police Department. They were able to come out. I was able to have a conversation with the officer in the driveway outside notice of my daughter or the young lady, provide my perspective and background. The officer was able to interview this young woman in the comfort of my home to try and address issues. If I knew that everything was going to be subjected to a videotape, number one, I would not have my daughter involved at all. And number two, I would have taken that one young woman down to the police department, coached her at the door about what she should do to protect herself. and basically left her. I believe the interactions that occurred in that situation on my private property with an officer were much more conducive to resolution and safety of this young woman and myself than the alternative, you know, if it was going to be recorded, of just dropping her off at the police station. And I think law enforcement recognizes that, and that's another one of those it's complicated issues. And I wish, well, certainly I understand that the professor is sick today. I mean, there are real issues within minority communities about accountability and transparency, and a whole different perspective on why current data practices laws don't help achieve the goals related to those concerns as well. And so I think that the legislature is struggling. My bias is that the lobbying community for law enforcement is very well funded and very powerful in the legislative process, and sometimes the average Joe's perspective, if you will, gets buried in that. So I have concerns, but I think that the time is now that something has to happen, because just the logistics of trying to apply a video data format to the current data practices standards, it's just many, many law enforcement agencies have said we are going to hold off implementing this technology until the legislature speaks on the issue, because it's too uncertain how we'd be able to apply this in our communities.
Thanks, Mary Liz. Let me give you a quick perspective on the legislative struggle, where the legislature is at with body cam legislation. The Senate has passed a bill authored by Senator Lapps from St. Louis Park, which is a very restrictive bill in terms of access by the public to information on the tapes. Essentially, it presumes the tapes are going to be private data. The exception to that is in a situation where the tape records an encounter between a law enforcement person and a member of the public, there's injury to either the law enforcement person or the member of the public, that injury is serious, and what happened occurred in a public place, okay? So if there was some interaction where somebody was seriously hurt and it occurred in a hallway of an apartment building, that would not be public. So on issues like consent, the Senate bill essentially is silent, which means that we take that to mean that no consent will have to be gotten when a camera is turned on. And so you know, MnCogi, the organization, essentially has taken the position that the Senate bill has some serious problems, okay? Now, what's happening in the House? Representative Scott, who's here with us today, has been working on this issue, I'm gonna say harder than anybody, for several months. You did introduce a bill, if I remember right. She got a lot of feedback on that bill. She had a number of meetings with members of the public and with law enforcement. She's reworking the bill. It's probably in its eighth or ninth iteration by now. Pretty soon she's going to have a final product and will either amend it or introduce it. Representative Tony Cornish is working on a bill. Essentially, we wondered if he might just adopt the Senate position, but so far as we know, that's not going to happen. He's going to have his own bill, and we'll be doing something with it pretty soon, either before or right after the session starts. So that's where things are legislatively. And of course, that's part of the reason why we're here today. So I'm gonna start out with some questions. I encourage any of you to ask questions in response to what's already been said or to what I said. As Mary Liz has pointed out, one of the big issues is how do you fit the technology with the existing data practices? Okay? Keep in mind, the existing Data Practices Act regulates government data, and it defines government data essentially as any data that's captured in any form by the government. So that means that the existing Data Practices Act regulates data that's on body cameras. Now, whether or not it does it well is an obvious issue, okay? What that brings up under current law, however, is to the extent that the body cameras capture various types of data that in the current Data Practices Act are explicitly public, then the assumption is, the presumption is, those data are available for public, okay? However, equally, to the extent that body cameras capture data that are not public, those data held in body camera format are also not public. That brings us to the big issue of separation of the data. So, when somebody comes in, Burnsville Police Department or any of the member of the other police departments and sheriff's offices that are now implementing body cameras, and they say, I want to see, for example, the public data on the video, on the incident that occurred, well, use this one. The incident that occurred in the hallway of the police department, it's the obligation of the police department to make that data available to the public, okay?
Under current legislation.
Under current law, yeah. So that then leads to, okay, you know, if it's a straight up deal, where all of the data corresponds to what's in the statute, then I assume, Chief, it's no problem, okay? It's when you get the subtleties of things like what's happening on a videotape is the officer is arresting somebody for criminal sexual conduct, and the person being arrested screams out, I didn't rape that blah, 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 and uses her name, okay? So what do you do with that?
And she said it's complicated. No, that's where the deliberate attempts can go through. You don't want to release information that you shouldn't. That's what the legal authority do. So it slows the process down, and I'm all for being transparent. Otherwise, we wouldn't continue to use the cameras. But those are the issues that I know a lot of people, we want to help try to figure those out. We can't figure it out on our own. As Burnsville Police Chief, I can tell you, I think they're valuable tools, absolutely. But there's issues that I think we need support from the community to try to work through those things so we can continue to use them. Commissioner Holberg said, there's a lot of chiefs out there that are afraid to use them because they don't know how it's going to impact the organization. And that's as scary as is happening, because if something bad happens in your community, the first thing they're going to ask the chief, well, why don't you have body cameras for your cops? The chief's going to say, because I wasn't sure we could handle them, have the technology, the data request, I wasn't sure. And so that's where the community, it's frustrating as a chief, the community is saying, well, we want procedural justice. We want transparency. Well, we want that too, but help us figure out how to do it so at least there's a balance in there. Because that's where a lot of chiefs that I talk to say, I mean, don't sleep at night because we don't have cameras. And there's a lot of cops out there. I would guess, moving forward, there's going to be cops that will not go out on the street without a body camera. It hasn't happened yet, but pretty soon I would anticipate a cop's going to get into a jam and say, hey, Chief, you didn't provide me with the necessary tool for me to do my job. And you give me a camera, you would have seen I was professional, public would have seen what I did was reasonable, and I would have been under. So, I mean, there's a point where I can see that happening. And so as a chief, you're kind of, what are you going to do? You've got to make a decision. I believe that I'd rather have a good plan today than a perfect plan 2 weeks, 2 years, 5 years. Down the road. And that's why we chose to go ahead to move forward, because I think the benefits outweigh the potential risk. But that's the real challenge. In St. Paul, feel free to jump in. You guys are in the middle of it. We're trying to, you want the community to trust you. You want the community to believe in your police department and your cops, and this is the way to do it. But yet, there's so many unanswered questions that the longer we wait, the more things happen, the more mistrust, and the more issues we develop, and it puts us further back. So it's a real challenge, but that's just my opinion.
Yeah, just as a point of information, to the chief's point that these kind of offices demand to have body cameras, there are a number of offices who already buy their own cameras and carry them, okay? And that's going to be an issue at some point. So what if you got a personal camera and a department camera? See, it's simple. So we'll have the dual of the cameras. So go ahead and check.
So Chief, you have
your campus for 6 years. What have, just from a practical standpoint, not theoretical, but practical, what has been the benefit for your department? What benefits have you?
At a real basic level, on those cases that might be complicated, to make sure that we're doing a report is accurate, reflects what really happened, that's one piece. Basic level as well, complaints that come in, they're easy to resolve and not be. That's been a huge benefit. And we can show the community, we can support the cops if it's appropriate to do so, if there's an opportunity for things to really do that. But we've had a lot of people come in, and I've used this example, they think we actually did something when in reality we didn't. If they believe we did it, they'll come and watch the video. Yeah, I'm embarrassed, but I thought we did that. So that's, to me, that's really important to get the trust. So they can come in, it's just not us reviewing something and then giving them a written report of what we found. We'll invite people in and say, you can come in and watch the video. So we've done that. And we've also done that with inviting people in. Once we tell them we have video, then they don't show up for the events. So interpret that any way you want. So that's good. And really, just on some of the basic cases, too, where somebody might be making a confession or collecting evidence, you know, on something, I think that's, you know, we want strong, accurate cases. That's been helpful. That's an entry watch.
Mary Greenwich, you spent lots of years trying to fix the policies, refine things, and also educate your colleagues at the legislature on the issues. Do you think that the approach that the Data Practices Act currently takes of saying, okay, we understand that data gets co-opted together, public and private, but we put the responsibility on the government to separate the public from the non-public data, and we don't let them charge for that process. The Data Practices Act is clear on that. Do you think that approach is still tenable, given the way technology is going?
Well, I think in general it's a good value or standard, but I'm afraid with video it's going to be, in some instances, just too cumbersome to apply. And back to the comment about the juveniles in public at the bus station or whatever, we may in fact, in this particular type of data class, standard of maybe protection, whether you are on private property versus a public event, if there's not an expectation of privacy. The other thing is that under current data practices, you can get copies of pieces of paper. You know, there may be some instances in the case of video where there's a right to review, but not to receive a copy. So if there was an incident that occurred for the transparency piece, and I see my news guy up here and getting up a little bit about it, because of course they want copies of stuff. But there may be some instances where making it available for review, but not dissemination, you look at social media or YouTube, or if there was an incident in which a video was released of somebody that was law-abiding but in a very bad or compromising situation. Once information hits the internet, it never, ever, ever goes away. So we might have to look at some kind of standard where you could get the accountability or the transparency piece by making it available for review, but not to in some instances. And that would be a new concept within the Data Practices Act, but as I've, for the last couple of years, listened and talked to people, I mean, everybody has a valid concern or position around this. And good public policy, I used to say years ago when I was on the Planning Commission and there would be like big housing developments that would come in, I used to say that at the end of the meeting, if everybody left mad, we probably did the right thing. Because nobody got everything that they wanted, if you will, but there was some weighing or compromise. And I think that in this particular situation, I don't think everybody's gonna get what they want. There's too much conflict between the positions, but if we can strike some kind of balance, try it for a while, I have no doubt that whatever the legislature passes as a first round of body cameras, Within the first year or two, there will be a need for some major modifications, because sometimes you just cannot anticipate the application of some of these policies, but we have to start somewhere. And a community that wants cameras on all the time and for videos to not be able to be reviewed prior to writing reports, there may be another community that doesn't want to follow that standard and only wants cameras on in cases of use of force. I do have to say, you know, my standard about that, I don't think that there should, I think that there should be consent, and that I don't think there should be recording on private property without consent. That I recognize that that can only go so far. Because when officers show at a particular home, there could be a domestic abuse or violence situation, which are one of the most dangerous situations for our law enforcement officials to be in. I respect law enforcement's position that they put themselves in danger on behalf of us every single day, and I'm grateful for that. And I don't want a policy to be implemented that would negate their ability to keep them safe and protect themselves. But I also really, really strongly do not want them in my home videotaping a call for service when, in virtually everybody's estimation, the officers are under no risk of harm, unless I give them consent. So the officers are gonna have to have discretion, because they're going to have the ability to turn on cameras on private property if it's an incident of public safety, or, you know, I'm sure that criminals never call you to rat out somebody else when they're actually the perpetrator. I mean sometimes, you know, officers are going to interact with people that may be trying to present themselves as the good guy, when they're really the bad guy. Well, these are the professionals that are able to ascertain these things. But it's super complicated. And the community really has to engage on this, and that's a frustration of mine, and why I feel it's important that whatever legislation is passed, that there should be a requirement that the local jurisdictions approve the policy for their city or county or whatever, so that there's an opportunity to have a public hearing, hear from the public, and decide what are the parameters for our community. What Minneapolis needs is certainly probably going to be different than what Lakeville needs. I was talking to Chief when I did ride-alongs in Lakeville. One officer to a car, I sat in the front. When I did ride-alongs in North Minneapolis, two officers in the front, and I sat in the back with some pretty unsavory characters that I really had no other experience with in my home community, and was coached by the officers, don't tell them your name, don't say anything to them, you know. I was like, oh, what are you doing? But those two communities will probably have different community values and standards for how this technology should be applied. And in my mind, they should have that right.
Yeah, I want to give one thought from the chief. In the situations we've been talking about, particularly the consent issue, what we've tried to do in the legislature is to essentially, when I say we, I mean MnCogi and some other people, to say, okay, you can make a reasonable case, in part based on the Fourth Amendment, that when law enforcement comes into my house and I'm not doing anything wrong, that before they videotape me, they ought to get my consent. And we got real strong pushback from that, from law enforcement. Okay? And when I say law enforcement, I mean the lobbyists, the two whom Mary alludes. So, would you give me a sense of why that's a problem for law enforcement and what you think about it?
Well, I think there's a compromise in there, not. One thought, and I've heard people say, having cameras on all the time. Well, then we're doing exactly what you don't want us to do. We're capturing information on people that they don't want to capture. So that's not the right solution. in their discretion, there's a piece, and I like to use this example. So in your example, the cops come to your house and you say, look, I have a thing that's nonviolent, and you explain to the cop, I would give my cops discretion, but yeah, I can hang it on that. We can, it's different than what I thought when I got here. I thought it was a violent domestic. There's a way to get around those, work around those things. And they say, okay, you know, in certain cases, maybe I don't need the camera. I would give far out, like I said earlier, if our officers can explain why it wasn't on and it's reasonable, I would support that. So I think even what we do in Burnsville, they don't report every contact in some time. Typically, if we're in your home recording you, it's similar to this. We've either got a warrant to be there, we've got your consent to be in there, it's a fresh pursuit, or it's exigent circumstances. So, absent those four things, there's a way that it doesn't fall into those categories. Maybe it makes sense in telling people's homes. Just to not record for the sake of recording, you have a purpose behind it. I'm investigating a crime, you may be a suspect. Or that's where it gets gray and where I get frustrated when people say, what about this scenario? What about that scenario? What about if I go to someone's home and they want to report a loved one missing? Should we record that? And you find out the loved one was murdered. Crystal, that boy's gone. So you have to have some discretion, or maybe you capture it, and later you realize it doesn't serve a public purpose, it's not part of crime, maybe you delete it, get rid of it. So I think there are things that can be done, but I don't know if I'm answering your question, but it gets back to there's layers, and I think there's things we can do. I agree with my commissioner. I love my sister, she's my commissioner.
It's always great to be on a panel with our constituents.
So, yeah, I share the same concern. If I'm having a domestic with a loved one and it's not criminal, I don't want to record it. I don't want it out there either. So, I think we share those same concerns. So, I think there is a way to find some balance somewhere in there, because I believe we all want to capture what's going to help criminal investigation or things of those nature that are compliant with.
And to that point, there are communities that are going to demand cameras be on in their homes because of their attitudes toward law enforcement. I am guessing that there are some people that want every single interaction with law enforcement recorded because they don't trust or you know, whatever. In my mind, they should have that right. I don't want to take away that right either.
And that's an excellent point, because you could be in there where you say, okay, I'll turn it off, and something bad happens, then it's going to go back to why didn't you have it on? But to your point, if people don't trust us, they want it on the whole time.
Yeah, because so, you might take their cookie jar or something.
Yeah, you can't make it so complicated. Cops are not camera people, so you don't want to make it so complicated for on and off, next thing you know.
Okay, let's go over here.
To better answer Mr. Danley's question, if you could give a couple examples of a situation where you could go into a home and not take consent, and that would be a good policy not to try and get consent.
Violent domestic, a call for service, a check for welfare, an unknown situation. It happens frequently.
And you, sorry for pointing, but that's
okay. What is your policy on people filming the police in Burnsville? You know, is that considered their right? It is codified in the manual?
It's law. We record it. Go ahead and record us all day. We have no policy against it. You can record law enforcement in front of a public place or in a private place. People record us. We can't prevent, as far as I know, Don. I'm right, I'm wrong. But if someone's on public recording, we almost expect it. I mean, nowadays, it's kind of a given, to be honest with you. It's 20 years
not
ago.
Not everywhere. In Minneapolis, people have been harassed.
There's, I think, a person in this room who was arrested for recording police activity.
Well,
and by the way, was was found not guilty. So, all right. So you're right, it's not true everywhere. It's still waiting for the cop who stole part of the video to be prosecuted, but you should be careful with that, I suspect. Here and then over there. Go ahead. Here.
The chief he was talking about, the idea for body cams in Burnsville came from the rank and file embraced by the chief. I'm wondering if you guys could comment on the very lobbying groups of the Capitol. It's not like a uniform block that you're the police, right? But you have union representatives, you have the police chiefs, right? You have the sheriffs, you have the prosecutors. Are there kind of any fissures here when it comes to, or are they all pretty uniform on what they want to see done with the law?
I think there is some tension. They provide a united front, but there you can see some tension between the police officers and the chiefs and sheriffs. The chief certainly wants to use these tools to see how his officers are performing, some of that accountability piece, employment accountability. And you'll see the police officers association are probably more concerned about being able to review the tape before doing the report, some of the information, how the information is classified, rights of personnel data. We're seeing that some move to have information about them if there's a complaint or an incident, that it be treated as personnel data and be not public. Kind of in that labor relations realm. So I mean, I hate to keep saying, but it is very complicated. And the one group that I'm just waiting for them to perk up is we also have school resource officers wearing cameras in schools, and I don't tell them, but I'm guessing pretty soon Education Minnesota is going to get into this, because I'm guessing the teachers aren't going to be once the teachers figure out that they're going to be on these cameras in their workplace, there may be issues with the teachers' unions as well.
John, one comment too, just on recording officers in public. You do have a policy that clears, it's legal for them to do it. It's different if you're off on the side recording. It's another thing if you're in the middle of it, distracting the officer. So I think, just to be clear on that, if you're in the middle of it and officers trying to do something, as long as you're not yelling and screaming and distracting and in the middle of a situation, I don't see a problem with it. I don't know if St. Paul's here, we can do it. We've had people get in the middle of something and it creates issues, and that's a safety issue. That's where we struggle with that, by the way, recording.
And how is the policy generally stated on that?
On what, allowing you to look at video?
Not video if they're too close.
Well, that would follow your current statute if you're, you'd have to prove you're instructed.
You're never going to talk officer yeah, the
court to the duties. I'm talking, you're right in the middle of it. Right. And you're back off.
And that can play out a whole range of different ways.
Somebody back there.
Yeah, within the context of retained video, who decides whether to keep it or not? Or who defines the public interest? Because earlier you mentioned whether it's or not it's in the public interest to keep a video. Who decides that?
Well, currently the retention schedule of data is up to those that hold the data. There would be, of course, the exceptions around if it's part of an active investigation, it would have to be held until the legal process works its way out. There's some exception, but current law, there's huge discretion. And to that point, this particular type of data may invite some type of consent for disclosure by individuals in the video. That's generally not a condition of current data practices, but if there's an incident in some person's home and there's a reason for a public viewing of it, we might give individuals the right to provide consent. for that viewing if it was something that, you know, happened in their home.
There's a relatively obscure statute called the Records Management Act. And essentially what it says is official actions of the government have to be documented, doesn't use the word. And those official actions, the data associated with them have to be retained forever unless the government agency submits a retention schedule to what's called the Records Disposition Panel. And that panel approves the disposition schedule for some period longer or shorter than forever. Okay. What a given government entity chooses to propose as a retention is, as Mary was observes, is entirely up to them. Once it's signed off by the Records Disposition Panel, then if it says we'll keep this for, this is a ridiculous example, but the illustration, it says we'll keep those videos for a half hour after the transaction, if that's what's approved, then they can destroy them within a half an hour. One of the problems with our records management statute is, number one, it's obscure. Number two, a lot of agencies don't even know it exists. And sometimes it's frankly used as a way to get rid of stuff. I'll give you an example. One of the controversies in my home city right here is that the technicians in St. Paul decided a few months ago that most emails that are used by the city should be destroyed either immediately or within 30 days, okay? And some people have reacted very strongly to that, including us. But, you know, if you put in a retention schedule that says that and it gets approved, then you can get rid of all the emails within 30 days.
Who's up?
You gotta raise your hand.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Gary, you had a question earlier.
No,
you
already
got
it.
Okay.
So
I was asking
the
citizen, who's the approvers of this, of these retention schedules?
The Records Disposition Panel, which is composed of representatives of the Attorney General's Office, the State Auditor for Local Records, the Legislative Auditor for State Records, and the Director of the Historical Society. Yeah, but the reality is all of those highfalutin types have delegated this to some munchkin, and they never meet, and the munchkins basically circulate the retention schedules and sign off on them, okay?
Can I ask a clarifying question?
Yeah.
So then, literally, Burnsville could have a different retention schedule for a particular piece of data versus St. Paul versus Midtown, different ones? There isn't a statewide retention schedule?
There are in some cases, at one point when people were trying to figure this out better, various government groups like cities and counties got together and tried to come up with uniform retention schedules and got the uniform schedules reviewed or approved by the Records Disposition Panel. But I'm far enough away from that kind of work on that what's going on. Well, now you get an editorial. We do a horrible job with managing government records in the state because nobody's willing to spend the money to do it right, okay? And the problem from a political standpoint, I used to have this in my domain of responsibility. I could never get a budget approved by any of my commissioners to do this right because it was, quote, never one of the governor's priorities. And it didn't make any difference who the governor was. Okay. James.
Chief, what is Burnsville's retention schedule?
So we have an approved retention schedule through the case file. We report as a case file to it, it's a year retention. The death investigation, be permanent. Very few of those, thankfully. And it's a citation, it would be 3 years. And then we have a category, it's miscellaneous, it's a 90-day retention. Or miscellaneous things that officers not really sure any value to it, or if it's going to result in a report. Sometimes I know they'll use that 90-day miscellaneous because, well, maybe somebody's going to complain maybe they want, but it gives you a window, and then there's an extraneous where we don't, there's no value to it, we have a 7-day.
How long? 7 days?
7 days. Representative Scott.
Oh, thank you.
could you speak to Burnsville's policy on sharing of video data? Do you have a policy on that?
Well, typically, if we're in investigation with another agency, we would share. As far as other agencies, whatever we're allowed to do under current law. Typically, if it's a video and we're investigating something with another agency, they may have access to it to help us investigate it. But we don't share videos that often with other agencies unless it's part of something we're actively investigating. There are other agencies out there that might have a need for it, and then again, we follow whatever the current law is, and some of those again gets. Our record staff is in touch with our city attorney on a regular basis. Clarification on those things. So we take them serious. We don't just automatically misinformation, that's for sure.
And do you have the same records retention schedule as you just mentioned for documents as you do for the videos as well? Do you keep those up to 7 years?
Yep, it's the same umbrella.
Legally associated stuff, 7 years is a very common retention schedule.
So I guess, you know, one of the issues is the cost of that storage. How have you found that to be as far as, you know, if every citation you have, you're storing it for 3 years, have you run into issues with, you know, the amount of storage space that you need for that?
It's a good question. We were unique, we were one of the first to do it. We've been able to budget and handle the increase in that. I would say it's really important to make sure that your local elected officials are on board because there's a cost. There's a cost to it. And so the pricing has changed over the years. The best example I would be to think of as a cell phone plan. When we first got cell phones, it was really expensive. If you texted, you were bankrupt, and if your kids were texting and you didn't know about it, you know, you burned the phone. And it changes. So similar to that, the cost is really, it's kind of a little bit, but it's similar to that in the We budgeted each year to make sure we're able to accommodate things.
Hasn't been an issue with city council.
Please. Okay. I want to go someplace and then I'll go back to you two. To clarify, correct me if I'm wrong, the city of Burnsville does not physically inside the city retain body camera data. They're retained on the taser cloud. As near as that, I've been able to figure out, the taser cloud is on a computer in Arizona. It could be in Singapore, for all we know, okay? So that, and you pay for them to store the video. So, and that whole issue of the data being in the hands of a private company raises all kinds of interesting, complicated issues, including if you need a tape edit, Chief, like the gauzing thing we saw earlier. Do you do that or does Taser do it?
We have the ability to do it ourselves.
You do? Okay. So, now there was somebody, oh, Bill had a question.
It was actually related to that point you just brought up. I was gonna ask it, has there been any incidents where it was difficult to respond to a data practices request because the data was held by, in the case of Burnsville, by Taser?
I have a couple of questions about the economy of scale. About a year ago, the deputy chief of Minneapolis Police Department talked about their exploration of body cameras, and it was amazing to hear all of the costs involved in perhaps replying to a request from the media for video. I wonder if the marketplace just has to adapt or be more responsive. Just in the variations of the camera that you had, the first one looked like it was just so economical. You've got it right here, you get in the perspective of what somebody sees, as well as being able to show. And then it show on a screen to the person whether they went through the stop sign or not. And now it seems like Taser, just the little that I know about and that I've heard, they seem to have the only game in town, or one of the most prominent games in town, and so that makes them able to set a price and make it more expensive. On the other hand, police departments wanting to be responsive to requests for the video, it was interesting to hear the deputy chief saying, you know, we have six officers that go to the site. You've got six tapes, if you will, that need to be edited and reviewed. And I just kept thinking of the cost involved in that. Do you see anything? I guess what I'm asking is, what's reasonable turnaround time to expect a response from a police department to a request for the tapes? And do you see any hope in the horizon for some economies of scale that somebody like Taser is not going to be the only game in town?
Helen, they're not the only game in town.
I know, but they're the biggest.
They're the most prominent.
They're the biggest one.
Yeah, they're not the only game in town.
Yeah.
And if I remember correctly, in the Minneapolis budget, they were budgeting for two full-time people to handle requests for data.
Yeah, okay. Is that enough? I don't know.
They'll find out. So based on your experience, you know, comparing Minneapolis versus Burnsville, and the media doesn't want to cover Burnsville because, as you said, it's a real boring place. Go ahead.
Yes, we have something of an answer to that right now in Minneapolis. It was just placed on the agenda, and the meeting starts in 15 minutes, where the council committee is going to presumably approve a contract with Taser for $4 million. The number that's been bandied about for the last 2 years is $1.2 million, of which we were going to get half from the feds. Whether this is in addition to what we get from the feds or if that's part of the $4 million is not clear in the proposal at this point, despite the fact they're about to vote on it. Now, I think part of that's because it's a 4 or 5 year contract. But that gives some idea of the size of this. And yeah, Taser is not the only game in town, but it seems to be the dominant one. That's for sure. So they are, and these policy issues are very important because it appears the city council is going to approve this purchase, locking it in place without any knowledge of what the policy is going to be. The police department is forthcoming with, here's what we want, but not with what the policy is. So that's about to happen right now. So we would also appreciate some more guidance from the legislature. So, you know, Minneapolis policy is at least in accordance with some good practices.
I'm going to go to Axel in a minute, but I want to clarify something. When you go to Taser and say, I need the video of blah, blah, incident on such and such a date, do you have to pay for that?
No.
No. Okay. Because I was going to go to the wrong place.
Axel, 2 points. The first is directed kind of the issue of cloud storage. The second, I think, will help answer your questions. St. Paul's a shopper in this market right now, so this is clearly something that we're really looking at. Taser does not own a cloud. They rent real estate on someone else's platform. And the clouds that, because they don't own that, so they're selling you space, and they're basically selling you drawers in the vault. They don't own the vault, they sell you space, they're basically saying, I have a contract with this vault where all this stuff goes into. And those vaults aren't in Singapore. They're all CGIS compliant, otherwise we couldn't use them, meaning that they have redundant, basically hard servers in multiple locations in the United States, and they have to be in the United States. That way, if one of them blew up, or someone, there was an espionage attack on it, there would still be other ones there storing it. Taser is actually currently moving from Amazon to CGIS compliant cloud to Microsoft's. So just to clarify that basically these vaults are homegrown here, and all of your footage is always proprietary to the agency. So to suggest that it's Taser's, or we have to get permission from Taser or VView or anybody, that's an act. Basically, we have the safety deposit key if you want to use the vault analogy, and only we get to go in and look at it or ask for it. And when we do, there is always a footprint. So we don't anonymously go in and look at things. Anybody can come in and say, hey, this happened, it was a very benign incident, and we can show you literally, no one has looked at that video since the day it was recorded, and in fact, for its entire life, until it got deleted, it was never viewed, and there's still a record that it existed, even though now it's been deleted, so we couldn't ever say there was a video, or we'd be able to say, there was a video at one point, but now it's gone, here's the schedule. Secondly, to your point about the economies of scale and that back end, that's where all, as a customer, as a buyer, that's where everyone is now pummeling their resources and money into. And that's good and bad. First off, it's having great technological advances that are going to be able to do things in the future that will be very helpful, because the video footage that you saw up there on the screen doesn't have a bunch of audio in the background. But every video we have, before we release it, we have to watch it real time. All 2 hours, because the radios are always going. So even the dash camera that showed the officers slam on the brakes and hop out, and it was running the entire time. If it's 2 hours long, we have to watch all 2 hours, because the radio is putting out private data all the time that we have to go through and delete. So one of the good news is that the market is now going after that issue, realizing it's so important, and making things where you can actually plug that video into a computer and have it basically auto-dictate all of the dialogue that comes through. So instead of a human having to sit there and listen to it painstakingly, you can see the printout, and then you can see the parts where there is no audio, and clearly go to the parts where there is, and start to then identify those spots on tape. The problem with that is that because that everyone knows the back end is where the money's at, when VView or Taser or somebody comes up with that technology, they keep it to themselves, saying, we have the back end that has this ability. So they're all kind of fighting with one another to be the technological kind of guru. There's a camera company out there called Bodyworn that makes a decent camera that you slip into your vest. So it would be horrible for Minnesota, because with jackets, it's not useful to us. But their back end abilities to redact and do the things, they have technology that really does the skin recognition. So you could take a riot crowd and it'll automatically just react all skin. So if you're wearing shorts, it blurs my legs, my arms, and my face. They're the only ones that have it, but their camera and their product is something that we would never buy. So we're not gonna buy a bad front end product just to get their back end part of it. And at some point down the line, that's going to end up, that's all starting to catch up with itself. But right now, as the chief said, we're buying in a buyer's market. I know many Apple situations. The cell phone analogy is perfect. None of us can afford to buy the 15-minute plan with the 25 text thing. We all have to buy the unlimited text, unlimited data, unlimited calls, because we have no way of gauging right now what's going to be recorded. And if you look at Minnesota departments, not other states, but here, what you find is they really do something that I think is a good thing to do, which is, when in doubt, record. Because that way, at least you have it there if someone asks a question about it. And so the estimates that the camera companies give us as to what we'll be needing to record based on the number of cameras, we always say throw those out, because our retention schedules are not set, and we expect to record more often than not to make sure that we're capturing those things. So does that help clarify any of that at all? That's one benefit of being a shop at this moment.
Thank you. No problem.
I just want to add, and I promise you, my house is not lined in tinfoil. I don't have a tinfoil mat. What I want to talk about a little bit is, where does this go? What happens when facial recognition technology hooks up with a gajillion hours of stored video in a cloud situation? I mean, those of us, the LPR readers, the ability to track or surveil license plate or car locations. But eventually what's going to happen is that in law enforcement's access to data for investigative purposes is basically, has no boundaries. Okay, they can, I call it the Mack truck exception in the Data Practices Act, that if it's part of an investigation, they get access to whatever they want, whether it be medical records, whatever, they get access. So what happens 5, 10, 15 years from now, when there's all this video storage of images of individuals that can be hooked up to facial recognition technology and 400 different databases of law enforcement video across the state? And then I'll take my tinfoil hat off. Because I don't know the answers to that, but that's the next, whether it be the Super Bowl in 2 years or.
So that's one of the issues that we're really doing a lot of community outreach on and really dealing with. First and foremost, let me clarify. For example, your example of medical records is a very perfect jump off point for this. In our state, and specifically within our department, we have people gunshot victims that go down to Regents Hospital here, and they get. And they're down there. We don't get their medical records. We don't get free access to those. We don't get them. The only way we get them is if the person who's the injured consents to giving them to us, they give us a medical release, or we write a search warrant for them. And then a judge gives us the right to see them. And really that's one of the things that we're really trying to balance, because every time you use facial recognition, which would help us mass redact things so we could release things to the public, that would be an internal thing. And clearly that's an area where clearly legislature, we believe, should have a strong voice in saying, if you're going to plug data footage, like that footage that you had there, that into a system that has a known database to it, clearly we have to write a search warrant for that. There should be a very high bar for that. And that shouldn't, and those should be the rare exceptions. I mean, we've really tried to come up with scenarios where we can actually see that happening. And the only one that we can kind of make up was, let's say we had our mobile field force officers out at a parade or march or a demonstration, and we recorded a bunch of people who weren't violating the law, they were standing there availing themselves of their rights. But then later on, an event happened where three members in a crowd that we actually captured on videotape, who were like elf protesters or some other group that has maybe history, were actually seen by an officer who was at that event throw a Molotov cocktail through a window. Then we would have to say that 12 seconds of that video that was recorded earlier today at an otherwise peaceful protest, we want to introduce those three individuals, because search warrants have to be specific. They can't just be a broad fishing expedition, into a known database to see if we can identify them, because we are able to say those three people were seen later on by someone else who did something. And that's the I'm a citizen first, the police officer second. I don't want to work in some Orwellian, live in some Orwellian place where people are just dumping data into some thing and just randomly hoping they see things. And that bar would continue to exist and grow, but it's something that clearly needs to be identified in there. And law enforcement supports that. Does that make sense?
Right, but I mean, when you start off with saying you don't have access to medical records, law enforcement can get access to medical records without consent.
With a search warrant.
Right, exactly. But I mean, that's, in some people's minds, sometimes that's not a very high bar. I mean, for officers, that's a bar for you. But for those of us that want to limit government's access to information, here's my bias. I fight every single day to limit the information about me that is collected. Now, that seems crazy because I'm a public official, but maybe it's a byproduct of that. But given data breaches, unlawful access, I mean, we hear about it multiple times a year. From my perspective, to the degree that we can limit the original collecting of information, no offense, I don't have warm fuzzies about the feelings of all the information that's collected on individuals every day. And God bless the younger generation. I certainly don't understand all the things that they put up on social media. I'm sure it's your garden of riches in your business. But, I just think that it's the whole power issue, and we as individuals versus the power of the government, and that I know I'm one little voice on the corner saying, hey, you know? But I just think that we do not know where this is going 5, 10, 15 years from now, and what the technology capabilities are going to be to put information together on individuals. And so I will fight at every turn to make sure that information about law-abiding citizens is only collected and stored to the degree that it's necessary for a higher public purpose. And this massive collection of data that tells where you are, who you're interacting with, what, you know, who's at the taxpayers' rally versus the, okay, now somebody give me the name of a liberal event that happens each year that I don't attend. The Pride picnic versus, you know, the officers, there's always law enforcement at the Capitol and these public events. Why should all of that be stored in a cloud somewhere? Why is that important?
Because we can.
That's not the right answer.
some of us have been doing this stuff for years. When you talk about the basic problem, which is data collection. The problem with data collection is as follows. If you build it, they will come.
and that's our history.
Okay.
James. Yeah, Chief, I'm curious whether any body cam video has ever been used in a disciplinary action against an officer.
good question. In our department, we've used it. It never has. It's never been a problem with discipline. I would say for a number of reasons. One, I think we have well-trained officers. We have good people in the street, proud of that. Good training. I think we're improving our policy. Good supervision on the street, and we have good discipline. Discipline to do things right. But we've used it to coach and look at how calls could have maybe been handled differently. And so it's, I look at it this, think of it this way, it's like a sporting event. If you watch yourself in a video performing, swinging at a pitch, you might see some things you might do different. So we have used it for training purposes. For senior officers and some younger officers and calls are maybe they work positioned right, or maybe verbal judo. Let's watch the video and see what you said, how you said it is your way to change your verbal techniques to gain compliance. So we haven't, and not that I'm afraid to discipline officers, but I think we have good people, and it's been there for so long, our culture is different. We've had these things that work, it's a different experience for our cops. They're just used to having the cameras around, and now that they all have them, I think it's just creates a different environment. They were professional before, and I think this just enhances that, in my opinion, for RP.
What the question then, as opposed to discipline, they were used as accommodations?
Absolutely. And some of our officers, they do good work, and we recognize that, and we can handle that. And this would be an example. I mean, we did a good job there. You know, look at some things that maybe.
So it could enter into job performance.
Yes, absolutely. We've had a lot of officers do really good things on video that we're able to use during training for other officers who don't do this work. Continue to reinforce the behavior, reinforce the techniques and the tactics that work to keep your life, keep citizens alive. We have three other officers that they're extremely professional. We use those for training. This is how you talk to somebody. This is how you treat them. It's been beneficial for that.
One of the disconnects that some of us see, and I saw it again this morning, Mayor Hodges has a commentary in Minneapolis paper this morning talking about how she and Chief Harto are essentially redoing the culture of the Minneapolis Police Department. And among the things she's talking about are video cameras. And how they're going to improve the department. However, nobody from Minneapolis has publicly ever said anything about the body cam issue in any of the hearings I've ever been in. So things like the kind of things we've been talking about, disclosure, how you handle victims, how you handle the videos of violent interactions. There's been no discussion about that. And I continue to be wondering what's going on here, okay? So Chief, in Burnsville, when you started doing this, what was the reaction from your elected officials, if any?
Mayor, the comments and the council are very supportive of our police department, and that makes my job much easier. When we first introduced the city manager at the time and the elected officials, and we brought it before them, they just thought it seemed like a good idea. So we got no negative pushback. They were supportive. They supported the pilot project when we started it. And obviously, they continue to support it because they approved the budget each year that allows us to have these tools. So, you know, I feel very fortunate there. I know our council, our mayor, she's proud of the fact that we have these members. She gave her State of the City address last week and said, I'm proud of the PD. They're 6 years ahead of us. Are we perfect? Do we have absolutely everything figured out? No, we don't, but we're willing to do this and try to help solve some of these problems, some of these issues we're talking about today is because we have experience. So I'm lucky. Now, that could change in the fall and be new elected officials. That could be out of the job, but I do think that's very, very important to have your elected body work with law enforcement so we can try to do the right thing and the best thing for the community.
Okay, this is maybe a slightly unfair question. Do you think you'd get the same reaction if a year from now people came to the department and said, you know, this thing happened on the street and I was involved and I want to look at the video, and you said to them, no, because of what happened, none of that is public and I can't let you see it?
That's your question?
No, it's probably the biggest issue that we've been talking about in the legislature for the last session and a half.
So, just to repeat it, when I released the video, I was told I couldn't.
No. The question really is, do you think there'd be the same public acceptance and acceptance by your elected officials if the law required you to say, I can't release that. I can't release any videos. Go ahead, Bill. You were the mediator?
To Paul Clark, they're saying they can't release the tape. Is this what you're getting at?
Well.
They can't release the tape in the incident.
The legislature passed a law.
No, what I'm getting at is in the Senate bill, nothing is public except violent interactions in a public place resulting in injury. Okay?
I thought there was a piece in there that if the chief thinks it would serve a public purpose to release the unit, it's not allowed.
That is part of the statute. That would be abrogated, would it?
Oh, it would be.
Oh, it would be.
Yeah, because in the Senate bill, it classifies videos as private, not as civil, as criminal investigative data. Okay? So that wouldn't work. That part of the Dead Praxis Act wouldn't work anymore. So, as to that kind of data, it still worked for criminal investigative data of other kinds.
Now, the prevent a riot would no longer be an option.
Well, it really doesn't say prevent a riot. Yeah.
I use the chief because he's that chief's words.
My goal would be to keep the peace any way I can do it.
Gotcha. When I was doing some presentations on another topic a while back, and this particular issue was front of the legislature, I would say that the public groups, who frankly weren't, you know, anywhere on these issues, and they would look at me and they'd say, well, I thought this was all about accountability of the police, and to some extent accountability of the people who interact with the police. So how do we get accountability if nothing is ever public? That's the problem. The studies that have been done, and there are several of them, and they go back lots of years, basically say what happens in the real world after video cameras, and you can confirm this, I think, video cameras are implemented is everybody acts better. People interacting with the citizens interacting with the police act better, and the police act better. And, you know, Let's face it, Mary Liz and I are resident members of the tinfoil club. You know, used to be black helicopters.
Yeah.
Yeah. But being watched means you change your behavior. Just it's part of the reason why some of us don't like living in a surveillance society. And we particularly don't like our children being there because of how they get conditioned. So, but the reality is your behavior is different when you know you're being watched. That's why, as quick as I could when I was young, I would say to my mom, I'll see you for dinner. And leave the house and go far away. So, questions? Comments? Back to
you. To your point that you just brought up, I think it's important to clarify though that I assume you're talking about the proposed bills that aren't solidified yet, but about the classification that would be private.
Oh, Senate bill.
The Senate bill.
Yeah.
The big accountability piece that we're fighting with our public isn't that they want to see everything, but there are specific stuff that they really believe they have a right to see, I most importantly, is police use of force.
Yep.
And that gets carved out as being public.
Not in the Senate bill. It's use of force resulting in serious bodily harm that occurs in a public place.
Right, but there are current iterations of that floating around. All of these things are nebulous documents that everyone's working through them right now. And I know that with Minnesota Chiefs Police in Paul, Minneapolis, we're all talking about making that so that we can carve out that our behavior is still allowed in there. Secondly, the other piece of that, because it's private, doesn't mean it can never be shown. There would be a mechanism in place to say, listen, you're not happy with your experience and you're the subject of the data. You can always get it, and you can show it, and that eliminates us from simply broadcasting things that we want to do, but it clearly doesn't forbid the public from broadcasting what their experience was. So John Q. Citizen can't go down the block and say, I saw a police car in front of my neighbor's house, I want to see it, put it on YouTube, but if you want your experience that happened at your house on YouTube, you could certainly come down and get it and put it on YouTube.
But if I'm a member of an advocacy organization, which I happen to be, and I research these issues, and I want to look at video to understand what is happening. You know, let's say in the chases or, you know, whatever particular set of circumstances, if I'm not the subject of that data, then that precludes me from being able to do video to do any actual research.
Not always, but yeah, for a big portion of the time.
I mean, I think that's a huge issue.
Right, and what we're trying to balance is how do we afford the protections to the victims and the witnesses that are saying, listen, we don't want to create a chilling effect with the cameras where now folks stop calling us or don't raise their hand when they need help because they're thinking this footage is, or this conversation or this intimate moment or this. I mean, we're talking about people who sometimes have their greatest and most tragic day in the exact same moment, and that incident plays out on video, and they're saying, listen, I'm happy. I want to report this, but I don't want to report it if it's going to be on YouTube or anybody can come look at it. And so we have to, how do we balance that issue? I think we get back to your point, which is at some point I think we have to get our head wrapped around. No one, if everyone's unhappy with what happens, we're probably somewhere in the right neighborhood. Because,
but we do have to find a balance, not just so much in that one direction.
But yeah, some of this is going to have to be spelled out a lot. My experience trying to help somebody be a confidential informant, the interaction with law enforcement was, well, we'll do what we can. Well, that wasn't good enough. And so what happened is the entity that was able to provide that constitution or to provide that confidentiality was actually a financial institution in which this individual was a customer of a financial institution. The event involved a bank robbery, and proceeds from that bank robbery being deposited in someone's account. Totally innocent of, anything. The law enforcement would guarantee anonymity through the process, but the bank, very protective of their customers, was able to provide that. So my experience is that there would need to be some guardrails around that confidential informant situation beyond what we have in current law, because we'll do our best is not sufficient to know whether or not that tape would ever be released or not.
Yeah, and to Axel's point, this is why I'm sad that the Kima can't be here today, okay? Because my sense is the solution you suggest may be workable for white folks, but it's not necessarily workable for communities of color because they don't trust us. Okay, that's the problem. I can't. As a white person, I can understand it intellectually, but I don't know how we deal with that.
Wow. Because we're dealing with it right now with our NAACP. We were actually asked to present it all the chapters in the state by our St. Paul chapter. And that very issue is why it's right at the heart of that, which is how do we not shut off reporting and communication, but also safeguard against inappropriate police conduct? And so their response to that is, when in doubt, record. Record, record, record. That way we at least have a third independent lens. It may not show everything, but at least it's a new piece of information that's available if someone asks the question, but protect the data on the back end by not making it all available to anybody that comes down the street. And that's right from both ACLU and NAACP. We work directly with them trying to shape and mold that. In fact, I'd like to say we're instrumental in getting them to actually, our chapter, to come down and actually testify themselves about what, because we said to them very clearly, listen, that trust issue is so volatile right now that if we report what you tell us, some folks will say, well, you're just saying that because that serves your purpose and you're misreporting. So we said, to avoid that, you yourselves come down and be the reporters yourself of what you're asking for. And they were not a legislature testifying to that and actually mentioning us by name and saying.
No, they weren't.
But the last hearing, where was that?
Which hearing?
The one I had.
The one.
The multi.
I missed that.
Yeah, five members of them themselves down there. And I know you met with them afterwards as a direct result of that meeting, which is great. So you can hear directly from them. How do we achieve these things? These things. And again, we're working with them. We really, if you want to simplify this issue down to really easy humanistic terms, our belief is that our policy should be in such a way that we can implement our policy underneath of a law that basically says, when in doubt, record. Because it won't be the incident that isn't recorded that now a question comes up, that's the one that's going to cause us problems. But then also protect individual privacy rights and the sanctity of folks on the back end so that we don't get victims to stop calling us or individuals feel like your private conversations on your, or I mean, let's be honest, someone could walk up to me in a public park in uniform and go, officer, and tell me something. And if they tell me something that turns out, which happens to us all the time, which turns out isn't criminal, none of it would be protected, but they clearly had an expectation of privacy. And if we violate that expectation, how likely are they to come to us again and say, officer? They're not. But if they think the experience was bad, they can open those doors wide up. And in fact, one of the things we've done with the NAACP is we're trying to make our policy state, if you have a person that doesn't trust law enforcement or now doesn't trust us because of our interaction, they're afraid to come down to our building and ask us a question. And I would be too if I didn't trust the police, right? So maybe we create a venue and they're open to this, but they want to make sure it's airtight so that no one can accuse them of violating any part of the process. They can go to the NAACP and say, we want you, as long as we do it in writing, to go down on our behalf and make the request to the police department, because our current NAACP leaders here feel safe and comfortable doing that. And so that we basically allow that process to happen in a way that doesn't feel like the person said, well, I knew I could go get it, but I wasn't going to walk into that building and be intimidated or talk to them in an appropriate way. So that we can again have that. But that doesn't occur if we don't record. So we want to have the footage, but protect the information on the back end. That's exactly why we didn't wait to get cameras and have a conversation with the NAACP. We started talking to them long before we even applied for our grant. And we're talking to every group, and we put the invite, and I put it onto this room. Any group wants to meet with St. Paul, we'll meet with them, because we want to hear your views. But at the end of the day, we have to have a program that we can actually implement as well. So I just want to be clear on that.
Okay.
Representative
Scott.
That's okay.
We run it down. Question here. Comment.
It's definitely true that we do have trust issues with, I guess, law enforcement in this area, because there are not a lot of officers that are from this area that police this area. That is a very big concern to people living in this area. If you don't live in the area, how can you, know the dangers? How do you know how the community is? Some things that you might see messier are, it's just normal. So we have people from other communities come down here and act bigoted and like assholes. That's the reason why there's no trust. You have police that beat on folks outside in front of people's houses, their cousin over there, grandma's over here, and you're watching this. And there's no assholes. So that's why. That kind of thing. And I believe if you're going to let people out of the academy, and first year recruits out of that academy, they got to wear it. They got to. Because they don't know.
Thank you.
One message whenever we close.
Well, I've got a couple of ads. Nominations for the John R. Fettigan Freedom of Information Board. Okay. There's literature in the back room on how to do it. It's on our website. We encourage nominations. Okay. They have to be in by
22nd.
And that's so we can figure out who gets the award and contact them. And now, the award is actually given on Freedom of Information Day, which is March 16th, and a ceremony in the Minneapolis Public Library and the whole auditorium. And we secured a great coup, as it were, because our speaker that day is Brandon Smith. And for those of you who don't know the name Brandon Smith is the freelance reporter who fought with the Chicago Police Department for over a year. He got some legal help to get the video of the young man who was killed, and now there are indictments against at least one of the officers involved in the shooting. So Brandon will be our speaker. So, okay. March 16th, full out auditorium, high noon. Cookies will be served.
Yeah.
Maybe if there's anything left for our budget after Cecil's
wanted.
So now, Gary.
But those are the exact two messages I was going to deliver.
Okay.
So my question was 16th or 17th?
16th.
Which
is a Wednesday.
Wednesday.
Yeah.
You don't die with St. Patrick.
I have a friend who wins a birthday on the 16th. And she was once asked by another friend, when's your birthday? And she said, well, my birthday is between the Ides of March and St. Patrick's Day. And her friend said, when is that?
I just want to say thank you for this. They are very good. So, thank you.
And thank you, participants, questioners, Representative Scott.
Question. To nominate somebody for your award, you have to be a member of the card-carrying member of the public.
Oh, well.
Everything we do is public.
Weren't you there the day I introduced, we were at a hearing and I introduced this as the transparency people? I got a couple of big rollers.
Sign up.
Actually, we ain't got a little card. We don't have members, except for the people who are on the board.
So I'm just going to amplify a bit what Don said about Brandon Smith. There have been 15 Freedom of Information requests to get this state out of the authorities' hands in Chicago, including one from Brandon, that were fought and ignored by the state's attorney for a period of 13 months. It was the lawsuit that Brandon filed to finally pry that video open. Hours before the release of the video, the same attorney that had suppressed the video charged the officer that shot McDonald 16 times with first-degree murder. So these issues with regard to the video, police video, are pivotal. And so we feel real privileged that Brandon will be there to talk about how. And interestingly enough, at the news conference where the video was released, that Brandon got released, he was not allowed to attend because he didn't have police credentials. But anyway, so you should be an interesting speaker. I want to thank you all for coming.
Sure.